Get Rich Education is brought to you by Ridge Lending Group, Apartment Investor Mastery, Norada Real Estate, and Producers Wealth.
You're listening to the show that has created more passive income for people than nearly any show in the world. This is the powerful Get Rich Education.
Hey, welcome in to Get Rich Education, episode 198. I'm your host, Keith Weinhold, and I'm going to answer a few listener questions today. Yes, it's been a while. I'm going to answer questions about your cash flow, your total rate of return, and finally, home equity lines of credit. And then we're going to have one of the top real estate trend trackers in the nation join us here later. Let's get right into it. Ellis from Gastonia, North Carolina asks, Keith, episode 188 had a great breakdown of how you run all of the numbers on an income property. The thing I'm wondering about is that your example only resulted in a positive cash flow of $150 on that property. Well, with the maximum of 10 conforming loans that we can get on income property, that's only $1,500 in monthly cash flow. Well, how would that be enough for us to leave our job? Thanks for the question, Ellis. And now, of course, not everyone that listens here wants to have their passive real estate income replace their passive job income, although many do. And it's not a get rich quick thing. We've never done that here. It's about incrementally building up durable cash flow streams over years. Well, Ellis, I'm not sure how many shows you've listened to. That example of the $150 cash flow, that was just for one single family home. And really for one of the lower cost ones, the purchase price on that one was $70,000+. It was in Memphis. So most of the income properties you buy are going to have a higher purchase price, higher absolute dollar figures, and often a higher cash flow. Really, $1,500 with 10 properties would be about as low as a projected number could possibly get. So Ellis, if you're married, both you and your spouse, you each qualify for 10 properties of 1 to 4 units in type. So that's 20 total. And by the way, you want to put those in your individual names, because if both you and your wife are on the same loan, that would count as a strike against each of your limits of 10. So as you buy, alternate back and forth between your name and hers, or whatever. You own the first one, she owns the second, you own the third, and so on. So that's 20 doors minimum right there, or actually 19, since your primary residence is part of that formula. Plus, if you have some duplexes or fourplexes in there, that might be 25 or 30 or 40 doors. So there are so many reasons why you would likely have substantially more than $1,500 in passive monthly cash flow. And then there are financing programs beyond these 10 conventional ones for each person. Plus, you also might have some 5-unit apartment buildings in there, some agricultural parcels, or a mobile home community, or maybe you even got a couple low-cost properties paid off, or you didn't even think it was worth getting a loan for those in the first place for such small amounts, but yet they still produce a cash flow even though there isn't a loan there. So there are really a ton of reasons why it would be way more than $1,500 a month. Thank you for the question, Ellis. And another important thing to remember there is that we're only talking about cash flow, which is only one of 5 simultaneous profit centers that you typically have. But cash flow is a key profit center because it is the most liquid one. Jesse from Sacramento, California says, I love your show. It has flipped my financial mindset totally upside down, changed my family's life, and changed what I thought was possible for us. Thank you. I love hearing stuff like that. Okay, and she, or he, it's Jesse, goes on to write, part of what I love hearing about is the 5 ways you're paid in real estate. Then he or she shows me an example here in the question of 30% for leverage appreciation, plus 6% cash flow, 5% loan pay down, 4% tax benefits, and 3% inflation hedging for a total return of 48%. Yes, those are the 5 ways that real estate investors often have profit centers. Okay, the question Jesse asks about, though, is this. Though I get my properties from GRETurnkey.com and these returns seem about right, I don't think I'm invested in any one market that performs this way. Okay, I love that question, Jesse. Yes, few individual markets are going to perform just that way. And let me also add, we're just talking about your year one return there. That total return of 48% is often going to get eroded, and you need to do active cash out refinances or exchanges in order to keep your total return up there. But to get back to the question, yeah, Jesse, it's a blended portfolio approach. For example, on your new purchase in Dallas-Fort Worth, you might not have any cash flow anymore. It might be cash flow zero. That's just the way DFW behaves now, but it's likely that you've been achieving better than a 6% appreciation there in DFW. And I'm referencing that 6% appreciation at 5-to-1 leverage is the 30% Jesse gave in the example. Well, then if you've also bought in Memphis, you're likely achieving less than average appreciation. That's just how many areas in Memphis behave, but you're getting above average cash flow there. So it's the blended portfolio approach that can lead to year one returns like what I've described with the five ways that you're paid. Multiple markets means that you're more diversified at the same time. One market, however, that's performed lately with a nearly equal measure of both appreciation and cash flow are some of the Orlando and Tampa Bay submarkets. So some markets will come close, most won't. They're going to be weighted differently across your five profit centers. Thanks for the question, Jesse. The next question comes from Michael in Astoria, Oregon. Astoria is a beautiful place. One day I went to the top of the Astoria column there. It's a tower overlooking the mouth of the Columbia River. Such a great scene. But here's Michael's question. There aren't any cash flow markets out here on the West Coast, and we have substantial equity in our $1 million Astoria home. We still owe $504,000 on the loan, so our home is about half paid off. From listening to you and understanding that the return from home equity is always zero, I also know that our leverage ratio has been cut to 2-to-1. That is a beautiful sentence there, Michael. Exactly. Michael's question is, what is the best way of removing our home equity to use for down payments on cash flowing income property? Well, thanks for the question, Michael. First of all, you need to decide for yourself if that's what you want to do with your home equity. Understand that doing so means that none of your equity is lost when you harvest it out of your home. It is merely transferred into multiple properties, and that act can produce a positive cash flow for you now. Of course, although the return from home equity is always zero, you got to remember that borrowing against your home equity does incur an interest rate expense that you need to go beat. I've removed equity from my property with a HELOC for buying more investment property. And, you know, let's drill down and unpackage a HELOC here. H-E-L-O-C, Home Equity Line of Credit. Let's talk about why you would use one, how it works, and both your advantages and your risks here, Michael. With a HELOC, if you understand how a credit card works, you already largely understand how a HELOC works, except that your credit limit is based on how much equity you have in your home. You can usually borrow up to an 80% combined loan-to-value ratio. So what's an 80% combined loan-to-value ratio really mean? Now, with your home, let's just take your million-dollar home and round its mortgage loan balance down to $500K, okay? This means that you could potentially borrow up to $800K in total. Now, you've already got a $500K lien on the property, meaning you could get a HELOC for another $300K to make up that 80% loan-to-value. So, yes, with this $300K available to you, you could potentially put $30K into 10 low-cost income properties in the Midwest and South for down payment and closing costs. Now you've spread your risk around because you're invested in multiple real estate markets. Now, to qualify for a HELOC, you'll need to document your income and your employment status just like you would if you were refinancing your home, Michael. People often use HELOCs for home repairs. Sometimes people use HELOCs to pay down higher interest rate credit cards, but you can use those funds for anything, a trip to France, a new fishing boat, whatever. The HELOC is essentially a second mortgage for you. So like a credit card, homeowners can borrow or draw money on multiple occasions, usually for a period of 5 to 10 years and up to a maximum amount. And it would be $300K for you in this case, Michael. And there are two time phases with a HELOC. The first one is your draw period, and that typically lasts 5 to 10 years. The second one is your repayment period, which can last for about 10 years, some of them maybe even up to 20 years. Now, the first one, your HELOC draw period, this is a really nice time for you. It's exciting. Now, you've got access to $300K, and you only need to make interest-only payments on it, which means you have flexibility. You can make principal payments on it if you want, but you only need to pay the interest portion monthly minimum. And your HELOC balance can be very elastic. Like a credit card, you could just borrow out $150K on your $300K line right away. You could then make extra principal payments if you wanted to get it back down to $120K after a few months. And then months later, you could run it all the way up to the limit of $300K, and years later, pay it back down to zero again. Very elastic. And it is a pretty great time for you. You are enjoying what feels like a windfall of cash, and you only need to make the interest-only payments. But after this 5 to 10 year draw period, the second of your two HELOC time phases begins. That is your repayment period. And now, this can be a real test of how responsible you've been with your HELOC funds during your draw period that's now over. Because during this repayment period, which again can last 10 to 20 years, you must pay both the interest and the principal amount. So your required minimum payment will be higher over all these months until you pay the HELOC balance back down to zero. And usually your repayment amount is calculated simply by dividing the capital that you've accessed, call it $300K here, by the number of months in your repayment period. So it's really simple math here. Now, before you originate your HELOC, beware. Occasionally, a lender requires your capital to be fully repaid all at once at the end of your 5 to 10 year drawdown period. Yeah, all in one lump sum, which is known as a balloon payment. So before you take out a HELOC, just ask your mortgage loan officer about the duration of your repayment period once your draw period ends and ensure that there is no balloon due, or if there is, be aware of it. Now, even if you do have a 10 to 20 year repayment period, some borrowers, they just still get really surprised at the higher payment once that repayment period starts, but you won't be. You've got to pay both principal and interest there. Just remember, your required payment will increase then. Now, here's a great option for you. Of course, once your 5 to 10 year draw period ends, oftentimes you want to keep your line of credit and extend the draw period. And a lot of lenders will do this for you so long as your home still has enough equity and your financial health has not tanked and those things are not completely foreseeable. So typically a lender, what they do then is they pay off your old line of credit simply by extending you a new line of credit. And it's just like you've got a new draw period. So now that you understand draw period and repayment period, let's talk about your HELOC's interest rate. HELOCs have substantially lower interest rates than credit cards, and HELOC interest is often tax deductible. Credit cards are not. Your HELOC interest rate floats. It's not fixed. Its interest rate is tied to prime rate or to LIBOR plus a margin above that, and the margin above prime and HELOC is based on your credit score. Your upfront HELOC doesn't cost very much in payment, Michael. A $300K HELOC might only be a $1,000 upfront cost. Now, let's talk about some risks associated with using your primary residence's equity for purchasing rental property. If you have a habit of abusing credit, maybe avoid a HELOC altogether. Since a HELOC is secured by your home equity, if you don't repay it, you could end up in foreclosure, and the same of which can be said for most any mortgage. Let me tell you about something bad and unforeseen that happened to me with a HELOC. It was around 2007 or 2008. And by the way, lending guidelines were so loose then that I actually had a 90% loan-to-value HELOC on a non-owner-occupied property. It was a fourplex, if you can believe that. But it's not like that today. So with your HELOC based on an 80% loan-to-value on your primary residence, say, Michael, that you're in a place during your draw period a couple years down the road, and we'll say you've borrowed $150K of your $300K HELOC, so you've got half of it in use. Here's what happened to me. Just using your numbers to stick with your example, I got a notice from the bank back then telling me essentially that they froze my HELOC. What did freezing my HELOC mean? It meant that even though I was still in my draw period, they wouldn't let me make any further draws for my home. It was frozen at $150K. Now, they didn't call the note due or demand any principal payments. I could still make interest-only payments on the $150K, but with no further drawdown. So there was another $150K there that just had to remain unutilized. And now, why did the bank do that back then? Well, a lot of unprecedented things happened during the Great Recession of 2007 to 2009. Even though the property I owned didn't fall in value all that much 10 years ago when housing values started turning down nationally 10 or 12 years ago, many banks said that you can't make any further draws on your HELOC. We're freezing it. And essentially, the banks were saying that, hey, we're worried about the value of your collateral that secures this loan that we made to you. So I was disappointed because I still had some open funds to use on my HELOC, but access was shut off for quite a while. That was the HELOC freeze. Now, I could have avoided that had I just taken all of the money out of the HELOC right away and put it in my own liquid bank account. Of course, though, I would have had to pay interest on a lump that was not yet invested. And let me just add here, you know, whomever you listen to for finance and real estate investing information and education, it really helps you if you can listen to someone that has been through a nasty national downturn. I've been successfully investing in real estate directly since 2002, and the housing crisis and mortgage meltdown of 2007 to 2009 was actually good for me, as I've discussed on some other shows. Now, for you to get a gain, your HELOC interest rate that you're paying should be the same as or lower than the cash-on-cash return of the income property that you're buying with these HELOC funds. That's because it's cash that you service the interest-only HELOC payments with, and you're really keeping an eye on that when your draw period comes to an end. Remember that HELOC rates have been rising lately, and they're poised to keep rising. Now, I already know what you're thinking. You're excited about real estate investing and building your portfolio, and you have some equity in your home because we've had appreciation lately. You might even be thinking something like, you know, even if my income property's cash on cash return ends up lower than my home's HELOC interest rate, it's all going to work out for me because when I consider that the income property pays me five ways, of which the cash on cash return is only one of those five, I'm going to be fine because my total rate of return is going to dwarf the smaller HELOC interest rate. Okay, I know you might be thinking that right there. And you know what? You might even end up being right and it's going to work out for you maybe, but now you are tilting into a riskier area and you're going to do whatever you're going to do. But the mortgage meltdown 10 years ago proved to me that liquid cash flow is what services HELOC payments. The other four ways you're often paid, appreciation, loan paydown paid by the tenant, tax benefits, and inflation hedging, none of those profit centers are liquid. So keep that in mind. And thanks for the question, Michael. Now, by the way, I've had some detractors in the debt-free school of thought that won't even entertain the notion of harvesting equity from their own home and buying rental property with it. But I do that. And I'm not telling you to do that. I'm saying make your own decision. But, you know, some of those debt-free people, they even say things like, you know, I bet you're going to regret your decision when we have another mortgage meltdown like we did 10 years ago. And my response is, well, wait a second. By doing this, I'm better positioned in a mortgage meltdown. During the housing crisis, some markets lost 50%, even 60% of their housing value. So in a meltdown, I'm going to be really happy that I didn't have a lump of equity all in one property, just in one market, especially one of the more volatile coastal ones. Plus, during all that time, all those months and all those years leading up to a potential future meltdown, I will have had positive cash flow the entire time. Now, I've even had a couple people, and some of these are just don't even want to ever think abundantly. They say, well, what if things get even worse than a recession and society is just in an all-out depression and everyone loses their job and Americans are massively starved for food? Well, then the person that rents your Kansas City property, they're not going to have their medical job to pay your rent anymore. And the FedEx employee in Memphis that rents your place, they're not going to have a job and your cash flow is going to dry up. I mean, sheesh, if we're in an all-out depression and the economy breaks down and no one accepts the dollar and there's mass starvation and looting and anarchy and Americans don't even have clean water and everyone's defaulted on every loan that they have, well, then the fact that you lost the cash flow on your St. Louis rental property, that is not even going to be one of your top 50 problems, okay? So I don't know what these people are thinking. Now, when you're running your numbers on a single family income property that you're thinking about buying and you get a cash on cash return these days of greater than 10%, you know, I want you to look at that cash on cash return with a magnifying glass, because many markets have prices rising faster than rents that can keep up proportionally. And you can still get a 10% cash on cash return on a single family home, but just not as easily as before. So I really want you to look at that closely. And I still today don't know of a better place to invest than with single family income property. And I do not think we're in any kind of housing bubble now. A bubble is defined as a price level unsupported by fundamentals. Today, supply shortage is driving demand. Therefore, it is very much still a fundamental price increase that we're seeing, and it's supported by responsible lending, so it's not a bubble. And in these stable inland markets where we buy homes a little bit below the median housing value, this is especially true. So know the pros and cons of strategic investment moves like a HELOC origination. Your goal as a successful investor is to maximize your ROI throughout your investing lifetime. So I frequently sell or refinance properties due to the fact that equity-heavy properties decrease your ROE, your return on equity. Financially free beats debt-free. The debt-free person, you know, they're out there asking a question like, you know, where do I think that I can be someday? And the financially free person instead asked themselves a better question. What do I have right now to make my and my family's life better right now? What tool do I have that I really didn't even know I had? What knowledge do I have now? What talent do I have now? What property equity do I have now? What relationships do I have now? So that's really how you want to be thinking. So thanks for the listener questions today. I only got to three, and there is such a backlog of questions that I've got. I wanted to answer three that I felt would be most applicable to the greatest number of people. Well, Adam Dada's Senior Vice President Darren Blomquist is back with us today. We're going to discuss how, among homeowners, they're staying in their homes longer than they have before, but renters are not included in this. So note that this is not a direct measure of transiency. And there are so many reasons for why homeowners are staying in their homes longer today. Low interest rates that they locked in years ago often means they don't want to leave. Mortgage underwriting standards are tougher than they were back before the recession. The supply of replacement properties is low. You know, to a lesser degree, our population is aging, and then the older one gets, the less they move. And the supply problem with housing is getting so bad today that people are increasingly using data sets of predictive analytics and AI, artificial intelligence, to tell if someone is about to sell their home. So we're going to talk about technology. All of that's next, plus where the more undervalued Midwest and South housing markets are for income property today. You're listening to Get Rich Education.
Are you looking for a roadmap to financial freedom? If so, we have a solution for you. Narada Real Estate is offering a limited number of free strategy sessions to help you get out of the rat race. Learn how you can create wealth and build monthly passive income. To set up a time with one of our knowledgeable investment counselors, simply go to naradarealestate.com. That's NORADA realestate.com.
For an income property investor like you that needs an income property loan, go to Ridge Lending Group. And over the years, you've heard owner Chaley Ridge generously give her time to you right here on the show as a guest. Ridge provides investment property loans in almost every U.S. state, and you're going to find out how they've helped more Americans realize their dreams of financial freedom through real estate than any other mortgage lender in the entire nation when you get started at RidgeLendingGroup.com. MC Lobsher is the host of the top-rated business and investing podcast, Cashflow Ninja, and also the president of Producers Wealth. Producers Wealth assists people in creating, protecting, and perpetually multiplying wealth in any economy through creating processes that help them increase their production, provide them with liquidity, passive income generators, and opportunities for enormous growth. Learn more about their time-tested and proven systems at yourownbankingsystem.com.
This is Peak Prosperity's Chris Martinson. Listen to Get Rich Education with Keith Weinhold and Don't Quit Your Daydream.
Adam Data Solutions is a company whose mission is to increase real estate transparency by arming businesses and individual investors and consumers just like you with specific property data that you need to make wise decisions. Adam, Senior Vice President, is with us today. Welcome back to Get Rich Education, Darren Blomquist.
Thank you for having me, Keith. Great to be here.
Darren, you do a lot of really innovative things over there at Adam Data. One that really caught my attention is how you're using pretty cutting-edge stuff, predictive analytics and machine learning, to help analyze how likely a homeowner is to sell in the near future. Tell us about that and how you predict that.
Yes, and just to give full credit here, you know, we're providing the fuel for those analytics, but I have to give credit to our customer, our clients who are licensing our data, who are taking the data we collect and then building these predictive analytic models and AI and machine learning and deep learning models on top of the data. So I'm going to probably be referring to several of our customers who do that on top of the foundation of that is the public record data that we're collecting, which it's important to have a solid foundation, because if you don't have that, you're going to have faulty predictive analytics. But so we pride ourselves in collecting really good, clean data that then we license to some of our customers that do this really innovative stuff. And I think is on the leading edge of what's happening in the real estate market today. But yes, taking that predictive analytics. So, you know, we have a company called Likely.ai, for instance, that provides leads to the mortgage industry as well as the real estate agents, and they're actually looking to provide leads to real estate investors as well, predicting properties that are very likely to, for instance, go into foreclosure. And that becomes a good opportunity potentially for a real estate investor. The CEO of that company does a great job of explaining there's really been an evolution. It's important to understand they're not just taking the public record data and saying, okay, well, if someone's lived in their home for 10 years and they have X amount of equity, that means they're likely to sell. You know, that was kind of the old way of doing things. And it did narrow down your list
right. A
little bit, but they're actually taking the data and learning from the data what properties actually are selling. And then they're also adding in data outside of the world of property data, social media data, demographic data, to determine what are those triggers that make someone likely to sell. And so, you know, he gives the example of, in the old days, you can narrow down a list of 100,000 properties to maybe 10,000 that are somewhat likely to sell, but they're able to go in and get that down to 1,000 properties and really have a highly targeted list of people who are very likely to sell in the next 90 days is what they're going for. And one example of that might be, which I think is just kind of a fun example to throw out there, is they can look at one of the triggers on top of the property data itself is if, for instance, someone who owns a house and is married downloads a dating app, that's actually a trigger that something might be going on and that they might be interested in selling the house in the near future.
We put a lot more of our data out there now. Yeah, I mean, so
yeah.
It gets pretty invasive. Comments in a social media feed, or perhaps you see a homeowner selling a whole bunch of furniture on Craigslist. That can all go into this now.
That's right. And, you know, there's obviously a privacy conversation piece of this. And, you know, just to be clear, we're not providing that part of the data. We're providing the base property data, but they're doing that. And then the machine is learning from it. It's constantly learning. So as they get feedback from our sales data of what properties actually did end up selling down the road or listing down the road as well, the model can become better and improve and learn from its mistakes or its accuracies. And so that's what they're doing with the machine learning and the artificial intelligence to really build predicting inventories is what I call it. And I think, you know, right now the implication is a very personal level application. It's for an individual real estate investor or an individual real estate agent who wants to know what inventory in their market or in their area that they're looking for is likely to sell. But I see this as potentially having implications going forward on us looking at this data and saying which markets on a more aggregate level at maybe the zip code, county or metro level have a high percentage of homeowners who are likely to sell. That could mean there's all of a sudden going to be a bunch of inventory in that market in the future, or there's the predictive analytics are showing that there's a bunch of people who are at risk for falling into foreclosure in the near future. That could be at a market level, tell us something about that market and help. What our mission is create more transparency in the marketplace at a higher level, macro level, when looking at the marketplace.
That falls somewhere between interesting and concerning, further to which side, I'm not sure. But when you look at predictive analytics, and that's one thing, but when we look at the present and the past, one interesting thing that Adam Data has put out there is that the average homeownership tenure has increased by quite a bit. People are staying put longer in their homes than they had. Back in the year 2000, the average homeownership tenure was only 4 years, but today it's about 8 years. Tell us about that.
It plays into this conversation about data and AI, so-called creating inventory, but there was a seismic shift, a paradigm shift in that homeownership tenure right around the end of 2008, which is when the financial crisis happened. Prior to that, from 2000 to 2008, we were seeing consistently 4 to 5 years average homeownership tenure that someone stayed in their home before they sold and moved into another home, or probably moved into another home. Starting in the fourth quarter of 2008, we started to see that increase, not just gradually, but pretty dramatically. And now it's up to 8 years nationwide. So basically double what it was prior to the recession. And I think, you know, this is one of those important pieces of how the Great Recession changed American housing. And it's one of these long-term effects. At first, it was not by choice. People were staying in their houses longer because they had to. They didn't have enough equity to sell. Now, that's not so much of a reason. Many people have enough equity to sell.
Right.
But there's other reasons. You know, one of them being, it's easy for them to sell, but it's not so easy for them to find a place to buy. Another reason is just that they have a great interest rate. If they buy a house, they're going to end up with a higher interest rate, and they're more interested maybe in aging in place if they're a baby boomer, and those sorts of things are going into this. But it's part of the puzzle of why there's not a lot of, you hear a lot of economists out there talking about how there's a lack of inventory available in this market, and one of the reasons for that is people are staying in their homes longer. But it also ties into why there's a lot of this innovation around finding inventory before it's even listed for sale, because there's so little listed for sale that the real innovators are going beyond that and finding that inventory before it's listed for sale. And I think that's fascinating, whether from an investor perspective or from a different business model perspective. You know, a company like Open Door is doing that and using property data to help them predict inventory before it's listed for sale as well. And of course, they're also asking, they're marketing to homeowners, so homeowners will come to them and raise their hands and say, yes, I'm ready to sell, before they'd go to a real estate agent and ask them to list the home for sale. And so that's all part of that conversation. But yeah, I think that homeownership tenure is a central piece to explaining why the housing market is behaving how it is now in many different ways.
I think it would surprise a lot of people to learn that the average homeownership tenure has nearly doubled since the year 2000. That actually shows that we are a less mobile society in a lot of ways, and great mobility really is an all-American characteristic of our society. But yeah, there really are so many things that go into that. Back in the year 2000, 2005, in that area, a lot of markets were oversupplied with inventory. Well, now we're under a supply constraint. Well, that constrains mobility. And you touched on it, Darren, and this is something I talked about on the show a couple months ago with rising interest rates. In the recent past, higher mortgage interest rates have actually meant higher home prices. Some people think higher mortgage interest rates mean that home prices have got to come down. But if you look at the recent past, one of the big reasons that higher mortgage interest rates correlate with higher home prices is, yeah, if you live in a home right now with a 3.5% interest rate, well, you're less likely to move into a home that has a 5.5% interest rate. People buy on a payment per month more so than they do on an overall price. Well, that right there, that keeps more people from moving, and that further constrains supply.
Yeah, that's a great point. And it's been somewhat surprising to see that the market has accelerated with these rising interest rates in terms of home price appreciation this year. And our data certainly shows that home price appreciation actually accelerated in the first quarter compared to previous quarters. I suppose if interest rates hit a high enough level, you would see there is probably a tipping point where you would see some impact on demand. But right now, demand is so far outstripping supply, that doesn't seem to be a problem. You know, even with the rising interest rates, there's still more than enough demand to keep putting upward pressure on home prices. One of the things with homeownership tenure, though, too, is that I think people are moving to a certain extent. We see that in the migration data from the Census Bureau that we've appended to some of our other data. It's really fascinating. However, one of the things people are doing is they're holding on. They're moving, you know, say from Southern California to Texas. That's a common migration pattern we see.
Yeah.
But they're holding onto their house and renting it out in Southern California. They're not selling it because the rental market is so strong, because they have a fairly low interest rate. They're able to cash flow often that property, keep that as a cash flow property, even as they move to a new home, potentially in another location.
And that sure is what a lot of people in coastal California think. And yeah, they do hold on to that home and they do have it with a low interest rate. But a lot of those coastal California people that have moved out and have kept that home, they just don't know that, you know, the numbers really don't work in coastal California. But that's kind of a whole other subject.
Right.
Because we kind of focus here at Get Rich Education on cash flowing markets. What I call nationally are those stable markets, which tend to be in the Midwest and South Central to Southeastern United States. They're those lower priced homes, often single family homes, and our listeners are getting cash flow with just a 20% down payment still. The characteristics of some of these metros might be Indianapolis or Birmingham or Little Rock or Dallas or St. Louis. They're just somewhat boring. And, you know, the housing values there, they just kind of plod along and appreciate slowly, but they're a lot less likely to have a big downturn. They're in a lot of these areas, too. They have really strong laws which benefit investors rather than tenants. So we kind of avoid investing in what I classify as the volatile markets in the Northeast and South Florida in the West Coast that kind of have the opposite of all those characteristics. But just going back to the national picture for a moment, where are we now with national median housing prices compared to the pre-crash highs?
Well, we are within spitting distance of those pre-crash highs nationally. I actually have to pull up the numbers, but it's within, I think, hundreds of dollars.
I know it's close.
The median price now compared to the pre-recession high. And, you know, that's at the national level, which is kind of great for a talking point. But really, when it boils down to it, as your listeners, I'm sure, know, where the rubber meets the road is what's happening in your local market.
Right.
And we do see an increasing number of markets that are not only have exceeded their pre-recession highs, but are way past those pre-recession highs. And that's a double-edged sword in some ways. That's an indication that we're in a strong recovery. But there's some concerns, so some red flags in some areas that maybe those markets are getting out over their skis a little bit too far. But just looking here at our last report on that, and you know, you're getting this in real time, but when we look at, there's 57 markets that are now above their pre-recession highs nationwide. And that's out of 105 total markets that we analyzed based on median home prices. So we're talking, you know, 54% of markets are now past the pre-recession highs. And some of the top markets that are furthest head and shoulders above those pre-recession highs are Houston, Texas, Dallas, Denver, San Jose, California, San Antonio, Provo, Utah, Nashville, Austin, Salt Lake City, Boise. Those are, I'm just listing off the top 20, basically. Actually, Raleigh's in the top 20. Raleigh, North Carolina, which we select recently rated as the top market for a real estate market among the Amazon markets.
Right.
All of those markets that I listed down to Raleigh are at least 35% or more above their pre-recession peaks now in terms of median home prices. And so those markets are doing very well. And what's it? You hear a San Jose market in there, but other than that, most of these markets are in the middle America, in the South or the Southeast areas of the country, or the North, Boise and Salt Lake City. It's interesting to see that's where a lot of the growth and the dynamism in this housing market is happening.
Are there any particular bright spots in what I classify as the stable markets there? And by bright spots, what I mean are spots that have more up-and-coming potential than other places. And I'm just talking geographically about the stable markets. So just, roughly the mid-Atlantic states out to about Kansas City, down to Dallas and Houston, and over into Central Florida, kind of that area. Any particular ones where one can really catch a wave that stand out to you among those areas?
We track potential single-family rental returns, and certainly those boring markets are the places you can get the best returns.
Yeah.
Those so-called boring markets. But the interesting piece that I think you're getting to is there's some of those markets that you could still get the cash flow, but they're not so boring anymore. And we're starting to see some stronger appreciation in those markets too. And just looking at, Indianapolis here is one that's might be considered a boring market, but it's 31%. It's above its pre-recession high. Oklahoma City is 30% above its pre-recession high. Charlotte, North Carolina is 24% above its pre-recession high. Some examples there. Omaha is, not quite as far, but 17% above. Another way to look at this is just based on year-over-year appreciation here, and I'm looking through the list. St. Louis, which I think you mentioned, it actually had, and this is for the first quarter of this year, this kind of surprised me. It was in the top six. It was number six in terms of strongest year-over-year price appreciation out of those 105 markets that we looked at, with a 15% year-over-year increase in home prices. Now, median home prices there are still only $159,000, which makes for good cash flow opportunities, but we've seen some strong appreciation there. And let's see here, Lakeland, Florida is also double-digit appreciation, which is also a great cash flow market, kind of central Florida there, 13% appreciation. And Ocala, Florida also shows up, also Central Florida, I think, there, that with a double-digit appreciation in the first quarter of this year.
Well, Darren Blomquist, it's been great to get an update. There at Adam Data Solutions, you really have a lot of the best in cutting-edge data, specifically for real estate investors. And I often get questions of me of where do I get my data from, and you are one of those top sources. How can our listeners learn more about you and what you do there at Adam Data?
Just visit adamdata.com, www.attomdata.com. That's two T's in Adam.
Darren Blomquist, thanks so much for coming back on to Get Rich Education.
Thank you, Keith.
For those figures Darren was using in comparing various metro housing market prices to their pre-recession peaks, those numbers are not adjusted for inflation. That's very important. Keep that in mind. So if over the last decade, we had a cumulative 30% inflation over all those years, then a housing price that's 30% greater is essentially the same. Very important distinction there. Thanks again to Darren Blomquist. Hey, I know that you're a Get Rich Education listener, but are you a Get Rich Education watcher? Get Rich Education TV is developing. We've already had a lot of people learn over there. Understand that there are a lot of changes taking place as it's just evolving, but if you want free education, motivation, and tutorial videos from me, just go to getricheducation.tv for more. Let me know what you think about Get Rich Education TV. And again, you can land there directly at getricheducation.tv. Until next week, when I'll be back to build your wealth, I'm your host, Keith Weinhold. Don't quit your daydream.
Nothing on this show should be considered specific, personal, or professional advice. Please consult an appropriate tax, legal, real estate, financial, or business professional for individualized advice. Opinions of guests are their own. Information is not guaranteed. All investment strategies have the potential for profit or loss. The host is operating on behalf of Get Rich Education, LLC, exclusively.
If you want to retire in 5 years or less through real estate investing, then pay close attention as I'm about to share my proven recipe with you. This is Brad Sumrock, and I've taught thousands of people just like you how to replace their incomes, quit their jobs, or simply have more income and freedom than they ever thought possible. And we do this by investing in apartment buildings. After starting with no experience, I managed to pocket over $1 million in cash and retire from my 17-year corporate job after only 3 years of apartment investing. And I have hundreds of successful students that have had similar results. If you want to get out of the rat race or simply have more income and freedom in your life, then investing in apartment buildings might be the answer for you. Visit our website at bradsumrock.com to get more information about our upcoming training events. That's BRADSUMROK.com.
The preceding program was brought to you by your home for wealth building, GetRichEducation.com.